Hello, welcome back to ASMR Pro Tips series. In this episode, we will talk about the setup. It's going to be done in a style of vlog, kind of behind the scenes. So I'll show you some tips and tricks that I've learned and picked up throughout the years that hopefully will be helpful not just to people interested in ASMR videos, but anyone in YouTube community, honestly. And as always, remember, it's a learning experience. Nothing is perfect. It's a forever learning. So just remember that. And if you don't agree with something, that's good too. That means maybe you know something better. Maybe you can share it with me. I would love to know more tips. So the first thing that I think we should talk about is research and scripting. Throughout the years of me doing YouTube videos, I've realized that the best videos out there are the ones that are the most researched and rehearsed and scripted and thought out. Now, not to discredit all the other great videos or popular videos out there that maybe were a little bit more effortlessly done, but for the most part, hard work pays off, and I think it's true to absolutely everything. Even for this video, I have personally created a timeline, an outline, I guess, or a little bit of scripting, you could say, where I've included different details of everything I want to make sure to cover, so that I don't forget it. Now, research is done when you train to sound more well-informed, when you want to make specific points and not go around in circles and not know what to say or just miss or lack information for your viewer, so you don't waste anybody's time in a way. I know it's harsh, but that's the reality. So when you do your research, I suggest looking at similar videos with similar topics, reading some blogs, books, or articles out there about the specific topic. It could help you a lot. And sometimes scripting could be not just about the words that you'll be pronouncing, which also helps a lot with helping you not have a lot of awkward pauses or silence spots in your videos, or have a lot of filler words like or and all that stuff. So just helps you come off more polished and more genuine even, so you can deliver your thought properly. Okay, so I hope that helps. So you might have seen me play with this folder in the videos. This is actually all of my scripts that I've collected throughout the years. And you can see me sometimes playing it in some videos too. I use it as the like a prop. I even sometimes do little drawings when I do different researches. So I do parts, all the things that I want to make sure I use in the video, as well as some of the things that I want to say, especially if I'm dealing with a specific profession, like it's a role play. I want to make sure that I sound professional, as if I actually know what I'm talking about. And I do different printouts and stuff. Here's Sleepy Pleasures, also had a drawings. And even though it might come off silly for some people, it has been a great help for me personally. So I hope you will take that tip to your heart as well. I personally like to color coordinate everything. So if I'm making a video with blues in it, you will see me wearing either blue makeup or include blue haze in post-production, or I'll use some props that will have that same coloring. And I usually have a lot of props. I have a lot of different light sources and background fabrics that I use for all my videos. Now, when coming up with your background, I would suggest maybe not overdoing it at first. Some of the greatest videos in the ASMR community have barely any background. It's sometimes just your bedroom setup, or just a wall with some curtains or something placed behind you. However, there are ASMR artists, including me, who sometimes enjoy creating an atmosphere. And honestly, it's just so pleasant to come up with these atmospheres. It just takes you to another level of creation. So I would suggest you trying it out, depending what you're trying to portray. If it's a doctor's office, just think, what would you see in the doctor's office? Some kind of charts, right? A plant. Something more sterile, that's more like white backgrounds, maybe more white furniture, and so forth. If it's a beauty salon, it's probably going to have some kind of pictures of beautiful women. And just think about that. But I would suggest not to overdo it, because sometimes it can take away from the preparation too. So for this video, I'm working on a full moon video. And I've purchased this backdrop. It was about $15 on Amazon or so. I've clipped it onto this rig, and then I steamed it. I have a little steamer that I just go over with and steam all the little wrinkles out. Then I thought it would be really cool if I make the moon shine. So I've included a light that shines directly onto the moon in the back. So you see, it's things like that that I truly enjoy for behind the scenes for myself, because it gives me just a different appreciation for what I do as well. So I don't just speak to the camera, I tell a story in the background. I know it's very deep. And as another option, you can always just go to green screen. If you know how to use it, if you have really good software and very good lighting setup and very good green screen as well, you could try and play around with just green screen. It's quite acceptable and nice if you don't want to do all the extra work. Okay? When you're trying to set up your studio, and even if you are just starting off, here are some tips for you. You want to be surrounded by a lot of different fabrics. Preferably very fuzzy ones, or the ones that have a lot of little textures in them. And preferably even heavy fabrics as well, maybe felt or blankets. So when you're just beginning, you're not going to be able to probably use any kind of professional setup tips. So I usually used to suggest putting blankets on the door, on the window, as much as I could to attach it somehow. Put a rug on the floor, and maybe something in front of me. You could put the stand. These stands are quite inexpensive on Amazon, and you can stretch out any type of fabric, or again blanket, or even a rug next to you. It will help to bounce off a lot of echo that you don't really want. Then some of the walls I usually cover in fabrics as well. It goes from top to bottom. And sometimes I just use it as a background, but also it helps to keep the echo at bay a little bit more. Or you can start looking at soundproofing with different panels. I have this movable a wall that's collapsible. It has been quite handy, so I did enjoy it. I would not change it, but it was a little bit expensive and quite unnecessary, honestly. It was just a lot of help for me after many years of struggling. So, but basically it's just foam and once again textured material that you can just make yourself. When you make videos, it could be a little bit of a struggle to deal with outside noises, and you'll have to be patient and either wait some of the louder noises out, like if it's heavy rain or you're neighbors are arguing or there's a dog barking outside. You'll have to learn how to practice patience. Unless, once again, you just don't care and you just go for it. That's good too. I envy your strength. I always have to wait it out a little bit. And I usually give myself some time to either prepare better or rehearse something else while I'm waiting for things to come down a bit. So the amount of light is really more of a preference for you personally. I do enjoy videos with warm light the most. So in most of my videos, I do use yellow light or like warm natural light. In this specific video, I need it to be white because I'm using more of blues and I need more crispiness. I have noticed that you want the lights to be positioned enough away from your face and at a certain degree where it creates almost no shadows around your nose. That's one of the tips that I've learned too. The least amount of shadows you have around your nose, the more even and beautiful light it will come off in the video. And if you need a little bit more contrast and shadows, you can always use post-production editing softwares to increase the contrast. Just lower the brightness and it will create a more even, beautiful look. Okay? So there are different settings you can do for shadow boxes. Here I'm using them just to bounce off the light onto the ceiling. So it creates a more flooded light. Instead of very bright on my face light. That's just something I chose for this specific video. Oftentimes I will have them positioned on each side of me from far away distance. So it bounces beautiful light onto my face and it kind of illuminates your skin from within. Okay? Now, as for ring lights, honestly, I'm not the biggest fan of ring lights. They're just very artificial to me, but I do use them as well, so I can say no to it too. I don't like the most when you have a ring light in your eye, especially when it's big, so it's actually all around your pupil. I try to avoid it, but that's just my personal choice. But I do like the amount of that it gives you. So here you will see that I'm using it on the angle. It's kind of leaning down. It's in a way leaning down onto my face from the top instead of being right in front of my face. Okay? And my favorite lights are these little bendable lights. You can purchase them in most stores, Target, Walmart, they're very, very inexpensive. I put white socks on them to create like a more diffused light. And you can put two pairs, three pairs, four pairs of socks, as many as you need to tone down the light and create a beautiful spotlight. Also, you can change the color of the socks and create a different coloring for your video as well. Those look very nice too. So if one thing I would buy as a first investment, it would be these small lights. that I can just position in different parts of my room. Sometimes I bring a letter or a vacuum cleaner, and I would attach it to it just standing next to me. So you really don't have to get like rigs and stands for everything. Okay. Why do I like these spotlights? They create these beautiful shining lights in your eyes that look so whimsical. And you might have noticed a lot of ASMR artists using this tip as well. Pardon my hair. And it gives you like this almost anime look to your eyes. Creates beautiful little glistening, shining eye glitter. So they make you seem, again, more interesting in a way. Light you up so well. Okay, so I hope you see the point of that. Sometimes they also create a beautiful contrast from the side, like this. If you don't want a big lamp over brightening up your skin, these little buddies create just enough of this little glow from within too. Okay, so I hope that was helpful. Now onto microphones and camera setup. I do enjoy using camera that is angled sometimes down, but actually majority of my videos you will notice that my camera is actually a little bit lower than me. It's my personal favorite angle is when it's more from this look like this than like this. Honestly, it's because this is more seducing look, in my personal opinion. And this is more motherly, caring look. I don't know why, but that's how I figured to call it. So this is less threatening and more pleasant when I talk to you like this. It comes off more as very comforting and friendly look. When I talk to you like this, it looks like as if I'm looking up to you. And sometimes it could be a little bit more seductive look. So that's just another tip. Whatever you're going for is fine. But just the difference is very obvious. The positioning of the microphones. I always do them a little bit lower than me, so I can speak more into this part of the microphone and not necessarily this part. I distance it just enough, so it creates the distance of ears. So you can see, I can put my head in between. And again, it's just a good distance that I've noticed works best. And then I would bring it up a little bit forward, so that when I speak on the camera like this, it looks as if I'm actually speaking into your ears. So I'd lean back. See my face, but it's far enough and close enough for you to think that I'm actually speaking to you on the camera. Okay, I hope that was helpful too. What else? Whenever I record my videos, except for this one, because I know I keep looking at myself, I do tend to close down this little camera here, because I notice I tend to look at myself a little too much, and that's not something I want. So I just push it away a little bit, and if I need to look at the time, whenever I whisper to you like this, I just kind of glance and see how much time I have left. And this way it doesn't take away from the experience. I know that some people do enjoy to look at themselves. I personally know for a fact that if you have rehearsed your video just a little bit, if you have checked out the distance that microphone and camera have in between just by looking at yourself here first, making sure that's going to be a good distance. You won't need the screen then, because you already tested it out. Okay. I have my recorder always next to me, with hooked up microphones, set at different distances. Same thing, it would test out the sound before I would use it in the video. When I softly speak and then go into whisper sometimes in the videos, and some people really complain about that because it becomes a combination of soft spoken and whisper. The problem is that I almost have to do it because from this distance, microphones do sound great with soft spoken, but when I've come closer, it becomes extremely loud in comparison to my voice from here. So as I speak, usually I would start quieting down and then go into a full whisper the closer to the microphone I get. Okay. Now, my personal favorite is to look directly into your eyes during the video. And to do that, again, number one, you have to flip away the screen. Otherwise, it will completely break connection. When you look at the camera, here's a tip. So, here's your camera, and instead of looking again at yourself, that you will see here on the actual lens, I look deep into the inside of it, to the actual eye of the camera here. That's deep inside there. Let me set you up so I can show you. So when you look into that part of the camera, very, very deep inside of it, it gives you an illusion as if you're looking deep into somebody's eyes. As if you're talking to your friend or your loved one or someone you just like or care for. And I found that to create a very deep connection between the viewer and the creator during the videos. It doesn't create like glass stare, so to say. It gives you more depth. And then having good reactions and showing honest facial expressions during the video, I've noticed helpful too. And as far as personal preparation goes, I like to either meditate before I make my videos or read some of your comments. I have a folder with the gratitude comments. Oftentimes I read them to bring myself up a bit, remind myself of why I'm doing it, so that when I'm recording the video, I'm not just thinking about myself. Which is very easy to do for everyone, agree? But then I think of you. Maybe someone specific message would touch me, and I would imagine them in front of me, and I would just think of what could I do in that moment to help them out more. And it really does help to loosen yourself up a bit, enjoy the whole experience yourself as well. Become more genuine and more giving in the moment. So, I hope that's helpful. I also like to hum. I like or even sing some lullaby songs to help myself relax and loosen up my vocal cords a bit too. Another tip is to have some honey. Yes, that's right. Just raw honey. I'll just take a spoonful and just let it sink into my throat. Helps you loosen up your vocal cords as well. Then I would drink some warm herbal tea. Especially chamomile is good, or rose tea or rose hip, whatever is your favorite, honestly. And another surprising thing is apples. Yes. I don't eat the skin of the apple. I like to just eat the inside of it. And it somehow coats your mouth, helps you remove some of the sticky saliva sounds from your mouth. It doesn't help every time, but it does help often, I've noticed. Just make sure you don't have any of it in your teeth left over before you start the video. But I have noticed apples and hot tea to be the best trick of the trade, so I'm sharing it with you. And also, of course, bringing yourself down, breathing slower, because in order for you to make relaxation videos, you have to be relaxed. You have to portray slowness and smoothness yourself, so that people on the other side can vibe with you, connect with you on that level, and match you. So in order for you to help people relax, you have to be relaxed. And I guess the last thing is to maybe smile a bit. I know it sounds like something from old ages, but you'll be surprised what a smiling face does to people. It's very pleasant to view a very welcoming face, and the smile goes a long way in that sense. You don't have to always smile, just from time to time. Also, to slow down. That's my personal problem too, because sometimes I have so much information to deliver that I forget to slow myself down when I speak all of this. That's why this video is probably not going to be the most relaxing one, because I was trying to put in a lot of information into a short amount of time for you. But I know some of you enjoy that effect too. But reminding yourself to slow down during the video take you to great places. Okay. So, thank you so much for watching. I really appreciate it. I hope that this will help you on some level, in some way. Maybe will inspire you or make you revisit some things that you correct, and maybe you could also even leave me a tip and recommend something. Maybe I'm doing something wrong here too, so we can learn together. Okay, so thank you for watching.